Welcome again to quantum field theory. This is the last lecture for the year, and I thought I would take the opportunity at the beginning of this lecture to give a short overview of what we've done so far, and also to give you a perspective on where we're going to go and what we need to do in order to get where we want to go. So we began this course with the objective of building a relativistic quantum theory. The reason we wanted to build a relativistic quantum theory is because we know that Lorentz invariances is essentially a symmetry of nature. As far as we know, we haven't seen any violation of this symmetry in any experiment so far. There's some amazingly good bounds on Lorentz invariance given by a variety of different experiments. So we're reasonably certain that Lorentz invariance holds, at least, if not as a fundamental symmetry of nature, at least so well that it may as well be. So that was our goal, to build a relativistic quantum theory. And that brought us to the topic of unitary representations. The Poincaré group. So far, everything very nice and clean. We studied these unitary representations a little bit for the Poincaré group, and then I mentioned but did not prove some points about the difficulties in obtaining such representations. The Poincaré group being not a compact group makes things a lot more difficult, as opposed to, say, rotation symmetry, where it's relatively easy to build a quantum theory with rotation invariance. And then, I guess the only way to say it is motivated by actually, before I say that, to build these unitary representations, we have a difficulty, which is that it's very hard to talk about quantum mechanics and relativity because time and space can be transformed into each other under Lorentz boosts, which means that energy and momentum can exchange roles in under these symmetries here. It's very difficult to write down quantum mechanical Hamiltonians which behave in precisely this way. And to make the search for these unitary representations a little easier, we tried, we invoked the physical principle of locality to help guide our search for some quantum theories that might give representations for these symmetries. So that was the main idea, to use locality. Seems to be a fundamental principle of nature as well. Maybe this helps us write down models. And then motivated by classical examples, namely Klein-Gordon, which is Lorentz invariant, we proposed our first quantum relativistic quantum theory. Namely, the quantum Klein-Gordon field. So the way it was narrated in this lecture, we know that there's these classical systems which are Lorentz invariant. Why not simply guess a quantum theory that looks like one of these classical theories and hope that everything works out? And to a large extent, it actually did. So we went through and checked that indeed the Hilbert space of solutions to Klein-Gordon equation do give rise to projective unitary representations of the Poincaré group, and everything looked fine. It looked fine except for one point, which is that the Klein-Gordon field doesn't interact in any sense. And so it's except as a very, very simplified effective model, not really useful for describing the physics we see around us every day. It has another problem, and that is it's a bosonic theory. And as far as we know, we're made out of something that's not bosonic, namely fermionic. We're going to come to dealing with fermions very soon. So we had no interactions, right? And that should certainly be regarded as with suspicion, any physical theory that doesn't have interactions. How realistic is this? Not very. So then we did what I would argue is almost the next simplest step, right? You should always think of these steps as in order of their simplicity. We didn't just leap into building something gigantic apparatus. We really took the next logically simplest step, which was to take our existing nice quantum Klein-Gordon theory and say, okay, how about we use that as a base station, as a jumping off point for building other relativistic quantum field theories? What's the simplest thing we could do? And the simplest thing we could do is start with Klein-Gordon theory and add a little teeny bit of a small interaction. So the way we implemented that in this course is we take the Hamiltonian for Klein-Gordon theory and we say, okay, let's add on a term which we know to be Lorentz invariant on the classical side. So we hope that it's Lorentz invariant on the quantum side. And just go ahead and solve this. So this is, I would hope to argue that these are relatively simple logical steps. Task, build a relativistic quantum field theory. Do so by looking at representations. Find the simplest quantum theory that admits a representation. And I argued but didn't prove, although you can actually do better, that you can't get away with, you essentially can't get away with single particle theories to get unitary representations of the Poincaré group. So we had to go to a many-particle theory, motivate, and then we looked for the simplest one that wasn't trivial. Klein-Gordon is basically the simplest one that's not trivial, that's also local. And now we study what happens if we add an interaction. And all the while, we knew that we were going to have troubles at some point. In fact, it's kind of, it's a beautiful thing, right? That the Klein-Gordon field is a well-behaved theory. It really exists in a mathematically rigorous sense. It's fantastic that it gives that we have a theory that's so precisely controlled that we can solve just about every facet of this theory. It's fantastic. But and then you might hope that building from that thing, it might be suitably controlled that we can somehow get it to work when we add interactions. But we knew we were in for problems. Ultimately, because this theory modeled with this Hamiltonian here has the structure of an unbounded operator perturbed, in quote marks, by an unbounded operator. So at some point, there was going to be mathematical problems. It's amazing that we got as far as we did. So I'll just write it. The operator norm of this operator is infinity. So we knew that we were going to have problems, and this is where they manifested themselves. So this is the dividing line in this course. Much of what I presented before this line, much of what I presented before this line, while I didn't present it at the level of mathematical rigor in this course, I could easily claim to you that everything before this was actually rigorous, as long as you were willing to sort of do the necessary legwork to go through and check all the estimates and so on. But at that line here, we had to admit that things weren't even going to be mathematically rigorous anymore. There's some exceptions. In low dimensions, for low values of lambda, this operator makes some certain sense, certain rigorous sense. But for the dimensions that concern us here, namely three space and one time, I'm pretty certain, I'm not aware of all the current literature, but up to this date, this is not a well-defined operator on any Hilbert space. So when faced with that challenge, you have two options, right? Whenever you are faced with the difficulty of not having a rigorous formulation, you can either give up or boldly go on. And what our forefathers did in physics was to boldly go on, to use tools outside of the realm of their applicability, of their known applicability. And it's a remarkable thing that they got those tools to work despite the fact that they weren't meant to work. So they got predictions out of this apparatus using tools that weren't meant to work. So I think that's what characterizes theoretical physics, is to have the audaciousness, to have the boldness to use a tool when you're not even sure that it works. And just to see what happens, to extrapolate beyond a regime where you can faithfully do that while being guaranteed by the laws of mathematics. That's what characterizes a physicist, I think, someone who's willing to step outside of the comfort zone of rigorous math. And I'll give you an example that we've encountered. In fact, the density of these applications was so high that it almost got impossible to keep mentioning this is a tool that's not being used correctly, this is a tool that's not being used correctly. But I'll give you one simple example. There's this equation that I've been writing. Here's a classic example of a tool being used outside of its regime of applicability. One of the key building blocks of the perturbation theory approach to quantum field theory is that the interacting ground state, the full ground state of the interacting theory, is presumed to occur as some kind of limit as t goes to infinity of the free ground state, the ground state of the Klein-Gordon field, multiplied by the time evolution operator of the full theory. Now, for finite dimensional systems, you can make some sense of this equation. In fact, you can make no sense of this equation. This limit doesn't exist for finite dimensional systems. This is oscillatory. There is no limit. However, for systems with an absolutely continuous spectra, this equation does make good sense, and you can actually deal with this and make use this as a tool, certainly for single or few particle systems. But in the regime that we are working, we have no right to expect this equation to even make any sense whatsoever. Another example of a tool pushed far, far beyond its regime of applicability is interacting momentum eigenstates. I mean, there's just so much wrong with that sentence already, right? A momentum eigenstate is not even a thing. And that whether or not these things exist in the... in this limit here is also unclear. And finally, of course, we encountered the use of a Taylor series expansion for the exponential. We expanded this propagator in a Dyson series. You don't need to write this down. This is just an example of the use of a formula outside of the regime of its applicability. This series here for finite dimensional Hamiltonian certainly converges. You can prove that this converges using norm estimates. But when it comes to infinite dimensional operators that are unbounded, the generators here, you can no longer expect that to converge in general. So these are, I think, actually those three boxes there are the three, essentially the three tools that we've used outside of the regime of their applicability to build an expansion for the quantities we've been interested in. And each of them goes wrong. And I mean, if you stick in things and work naively, then you will be able to produce counterexamples to all three of these things. And what happens when you use tools outside of the regime of their applicability is they punish you. And they punished us. We encountered infinities in quantities that ought to be finite. And really, honestly, you shouldn't have been surprised by this. In fact, if we didn't encounter infinities for quantities that should be finite, then that would be much more dramatic than if we do. So the first observation to make about these infinities and quantities that ought to be finite is that some can be trivially removed. And I think the best example here, by far, is the shift of the ground state energy, which we had to invoke to talk about Klein-Gordon theory as a quantum theory. We already had to invoke this shift of energy by an infinite constant in order to talk about the Klein-Gordon field. We exploited that we can do that, and that has no measurable consequence. I mean, you can get away with that by using things called derivations, and you don't have to worry about that anymore. But if you want to talk about operators, you need to worry about shifts. Now, that's okay. A shift like that in an unobservable parameter is fine. It's operationally fine, let's say. Of course, if you include gravity, then all bets are off because that becomes an observable quantity. But we'll try and work without gravity, although I guess it's modern. Our modern understanding is now that gravity is somehow built into all quantum theories, which is a very interesting story, interesting piece of work in progress that I can't talk about in this lecture, but would love to. Some can be trivially removed. Some infinities. So such an infinity has no operational consequence. We had others that were, I would argue, of a similar nature of not harmful. Some infinities. Can be factored away, also in a sense, by rescaling unobservable quantities. So the example that I would give there is the factorization of vacuum bubbles argument, which is roughly speaking saying something like that. And in the rest, in the last part of this lecture, we're going to talk about a very similar argument that gets rid of infinities on external lines. They also have this factoring away nature. So these are all examples of a broken machine being patched up in order to get it to go just a little bit further. You know, the car has a hole in the petrol tank and the petrol is leaking out of the petrol tank, and you use some chewing gum and you stick the chewing gum on the hole to stop the petrol coming out. And you get a little bit further this way. I've actually seen people do this. What's more terrifying is when they get the drill out and they drill the hole into the petrol tank in order to release pressure. Now, these are examples of quick fixes that make the apparatus go a little bit further in order to get some kind of prediction out at the end. And let's make, you know, the absolute objective here is to make predictions for physical phenomena. And then, after the fact, justify why they worked. And that's a strategy that's worked well in physics. You take the Dirac delta function, for example. Physicists worked with this before it had a rigorous framework for many years. It was a very successful tool. And they were confident that after the fact it would be fixed up because, well, you know, it matched the experiments. Therefore, the math had to be right in some sense, and indeed it was. It's just the some sense that needed thinking about. But there's finally, right, these broken tools will give us some infinities that won't go away. In this diagram here, no argument with shifts of vacuum energy, no argument with factorizations will save you. And this should convince you, finally, I hope, when you write down something like this and you get an infinity, that maybe that was wrong. Maybe it was this step here that was wrong. Maybe adding the interactions like that was the thing that caused all our problems. And in a sense, the answer is yes. This thing is the thing that causes all our unhappinesses. It's this, writing down this model here and saying that that's a healthy physical model. That is the thing that's wrong. And the way we now deal with that is we admit that it's wrong as written, and we write down what's almost the very next best thing, which is to say, a question? We have the very next best thing, which is to say, this is really a family of models that work up to some cutoff beyond which we don't know what's going on anyway. And these family of models, we can make sense of. So by putting a cutoff on a theory, you're basically changing the operator norm from infinity to just a large number. Morally. So as soon as you make the operator norm of some operator finite, well, then actually everything converges and everything will be fine. Now, the reason I say morally is there's so many ways to impose this cutoff that sometimes that's not actually true. You get an infinity here, but you can still make sense of the perturbation series. They give you finite numbers. There's a bewildering variety of ways of cutting off a theory, adding in this one parameter dependence of the theory. And I don't want to say that they all provide you with an operator, with a finite operator norm, because some of them don't even give rise to Hilbert spaces. They work in a different way. But we've gradually understood, and this is what will be the content of our next course, how all of these different ways of cutting off a theory are in fact all related. And that's due to Wilson and the renormalization group. But for the purposes of this course, you can think of what we're doing here is saying we've got a hypothesis now for the theory that we're dealing with. It isn't just the theory with one value of lambda, but it's a theory where the it's a family of theories depending on some extra additional parameter lambda that has the effect of cutting off the theory like this. Now, it's perfectly fine to write down such theories. I'll give you an example in a second. I'll give you the quickest and simplest example of a cutoff theory. The cutoff quantum harmonic oscillator. By now, all of you should know this Hamiltonian. It's the quantum harmonic oscillator. That's an unbounded operator. We could definitely argue that we haven't observed an energy beyond some largest energy, right? There's got to be a cutoff or a limit to the energies we've observed in the universe, because our experimental apparatuses couldn't write down all the digits of the largest energy we've ever observed. There's some kind of limit. So effectively, we could model all the physics of the universe not with this operator, but we could replace this operator with this one over here. Should put a half in there, I suppose. Now, n could be big. It could be 10 to the 185, right? Or it could be 10 to the 10 to the 10 to the 34. This n here, you know, infinity is a long way away from any finite number, so. And that operator's got a bounded operator norm. If you perturb that operator, all your perturbation series will converge. I mean, this is a finite dimensional matrix now. Everything is beautiful with this operator. And it's even matches every observation we've made of quantum harmonic oscillators ever. Because it really is exactly the quantum harmonic oscillator up to some extraordinarily large value of n. So there's an example of a cutoff Hamiltonian and how things become beautifully well behaved. There's a big concern with cutoffs, however. As soon as you add in something like that, you should be legitimately concerned that observable quantities depend on the cutoff. The answer is it's bad. They shouldn't depend on the cutoff, unless you think on physical grounds they should. You know, with a material like a solid, you know that physical quantities ought to depend on the cutoff when they begin to probe the lattice structure of the atoms making up the material. So that's okay. Now we're talking about dependences which are, for example, the pressure of the gas inside the box depends on this cutoff lambda. That would be bad, right? That would make the theory not well defined. And the idea is beautifully simple. The way we deal with this, and the way that actually works, is we allow unobservable coupling constants or parameters to absorb, we shift unobservable parameters to absorb that dependence on lambda in all physical quantities. That is the answer. That's what renormalization is. Right, RG for renormalization group. So I'll give you an example of what this looks like in practice. You start with a hypothesis. A hypothesis takes the form of a Hamiltonian that depends on some coupling constants that are free to be fixed by experiments, right? That's key words here, fixed by experiments. And I'll give you an example over here. Lambda M So a good example of a model with free parameters is 5-4 theory. It has two free parameters, the coupling constant lambda, and also the mass of the particle itself. M is a free parameter that's fixed by experiments. Everything goes wrong, so you add a cutoff. That gives you a new family of models that depend on an extra parameter, lambda, the cutoff, this unphysical thing here. These numbers, Z1 through to Zn, are they real numbers? The answer is they're as real as your experiments. There's not usually a one-to-one bijective mapping between values of these numbers here and physical quantities. It's a really important point here. So I'm going to put that on another board, actually. The numbers Z1 through to Zn are fixed by experiments. And whether this model is well behaved or not, let's assume it's well behaved. When you solve a model like this, it's going to give you a list, maybe an infinite list, of observable values. Magnetization, density, pressure, temperature. You get a list of observable quantities, O, let's call them OJ. These are numbers, OJ. And each of these depend on those parameters. But they're very complicated functions of those parameters. Now, an example is the difference of the first eigenvalue and the second eigenvalue of a Hamiltonian. That's an observable quantity. It's a spectral gap. That's insensitive to shifts. So here's an example of where a parameter doesn't directly map bijectively onto a physical quantity. You start with your Hamiltonian depending on all these free parameters Z1 through to Zn that you're going to try and fix with your experiment. You compute a list of observable quantities which obviously depend on Z1 through to Zn, but in a horrendously complicated way. I mean, they come from diagonalizing a matrix and they're at least high order polynomials, if not transcendental functions. And then to highlight that the dependence may not even be one-to-one, we could consider the dependence on, say, the coupling constant which multiplies the identity in the Hamiltonian. So if your Hamiltonian depends on the identity term and like the rest of the stuff, then the observable quantity, which is this spectral difference here, does not depend on Z1 at all. I mean, it just, you can shift it arbitrarily. And in fact, no observable quantity depends on Z1. So the map from parameters, so if you think of this as like the manifold of parameters that you're allowed to shift in your model, this is like some smooth manifold, you're allowed to go in the Z1 direction, Z2 direction, Z3 direction. The map from this space to the manifold of physical quantities is some bizarre nonlinear map that collapses things, and it's very, very strange map. Some things you can say, for example, this map it doesn't care about the Z1 direction. So if you add a cutoff to your theory, and then you write out your list of observable physical quantities, then the first thing you will note, of course, is that as we've added a cutoff, there's going to be some dependence of the cutoff in our physical observable quantities. That's a trivial statement, right? Now comes the most important observation of the whole story. These are observable quantities, so they're fixed by experimental values, right? If you go out, you could, at least in principle, do an experiment and you could fix every one of these observable quantities by your experiment. So you could first check the spectral difference between the ground state and the first excited state by some interference. You could excite a particle, do some interference experiment, get that difference there, and so on. You can imagine doing all these experiments up to infinity that fixes all these OJs, all these complicated functions of the parameters Z1 through to Zn. And that if you look at this set of equations here, fixed numbers, OJ exp, equals functions like this, then, if you're lucky, you might be able to allow these coupling unobservable quantities, you might be able to solve for them in such a way that the observable quantities do not depend on this parameter lambda. Sorry. That might happen, right? That's logically a possibility. you might be able to find a family of parameters z1 through to zn, which have to depend on lambda, such that all observable physical quantities don't depend on lambda. That might be possible, if you're lucky. And if you can do that, you call your theory renormalizable. If we have a Hamiltonian which is lucky like this, we call it renormalizable. This is a huge constraint, right? Not every theory is going to be lucky. But some might be. Very constraining. This is a hugely constrained set of equations, right? It's absolutely overdetermined. We have a finite number of parameters and an infinite list of equations that we want to solve. So it's not likely when you have such an overdetermined set, overdetermined. It's not usually the case that when you have an overdetermined set of equations that you can find a solution, but I claim there exist lucky theories, these renormalizable theories. And 5-4 theory is indeed an example of such a theory. And renormalizable theories are as good as having no cutoff. Renormalizable theories are effectively, they don't have a cutoff because all the remaining infinities you encounter in a renormalizable theory can be eliminated by changing the order of your limits. So all the infinities we've seen so far stemmed from the cutoff being already infinity, there being no cutoff. So we took the cutoff to infinity, then computed our physical quantities. However, if instead you compute your physical quantities, then take your cutoff to infinity, you might be able to arrange for your theory to have no divergences in any physical quantity whatsoever. So that's the spirit of renormalization. And it's in that sense that our ad hoc calculations and removals of infinity should be understood. What we're going to do is we're going to throw away first all the divergences, infinities on things that aren't observable, be left with the ones that are somehow observable, then impose a cutoff, then eliminate these final ones by rescaling unobservable parameters, and then we take the cutoff to infinity. And that works. And in operationally, that's at least well justified on operational grounds, because if you have divergences in things that aren't, I mean, if you can rescale things that you cannot observe, then that has no physical consequence. So that. That's okay. Yep. Question?
Yeah. It's always possible to type these unobservable shifts to use these renormalization things and set up this infinity.
Is it always possible? Is that your question? Yeah. The question is it always possible to shift unobservable parameters to get rid of infinities? Answer, almost always, no. In fact, that's why we focus on phi 4 theory, because there it is possible. But for phi 6 theory, it's not. If you write down linear gravity, linear plane gravity, the first linear approximation to Einstein's equations, in 3 plus 1 space-time dimensions, and you try and run this program, then it does not work. But if you write down QCD, quantum chromodynamics, as a perturbation of a linear theory that we're going to write down in this in the next course, this program does work. The standard model, which you've heard about, is a very complicated implementation of all of this, where the base Hamiltonian is comprised of lots and lots of free theories. There are all these interactions that are added, and then this program is implemented to shift all these unobservable parameters to lead to quantities that don't depend on the cutoff. And the standard model is basically the most general model you can write down where this program will work. If you were to add one more interaction term, if you added a parameter in the standard model Hamiltonian, you added another interaction, poof, everything would explode. So it's very, very, very highly overdetermined set of equations you have to solve, and it's very rare that you find a solution. And when you do, you call them renormalizable. And theories that don't, where this doesn't work, like gravity, are called not renormalizable. And there you know you need something new. But for renormalizable theories, this works. So Navier-Stokes equations is not a renormalizable equation, not a renormalizable theory. For example, so it's in this context that our ad hoc calculations should be understood. Our ad hoc calculations that we've been doing so far are an attempt to factorize out as many infinities that you can deal with shifts, simple shifts, to leave us with the infinities that we have to deal with cutoffs. So I'll return now to the main thread of this lecture, which was scattering theory. So scattering observables are definitely observable in an experiment. They're very simple, right? Children can do scattering experiments. You take two things and you hit them. So any quantity that you get from a scattering experiment has an operational meaning. And so it better be the case that if you see a divergence in those, that you can eliminate it either with a cutoff or with some kind of factorization argument. Now, the final remark to make here is that all of this could be made rigorous, actually. There's not a difficulty here in making this rigorous. As far as I know, this is only just being attempted now, the program of making this rigorous, this approach. And in fact, the way people have been happy to do this is they've been happy to use the tools that don't work in the regime of their applicability and just to implement this program using tools that are not strictly applicable. And basically, it's fine. Good. So where were we? We were calculating quantities like this. So when you calculate a scattering experiment, an amplitude for a scattering experiment, we used all these boxes that I wrote down at the beginning of the lecture to reduce your problem to calculating terms like this. And we had this generalized Wick's theorem. To deal with expressions like this. So for today, I'm just going to write down the kind of terms that appear when you apply generalized Wick's theorem to expressions like that. So we're at the point now where we can compute everything. Okay, there's going to be three different kinds of terms that we're going to encounter in doing Wick's theorem to this quantity here. We've got the fully contracted terms, we've got the not quite fully contracted terms, and we've got the uncontracted terms. Fully contracted terms. We'll call them type 1 terms. We've got not quite fully contracted terms. We're going to call them type 2. I'll write out a couple more. You can see that that not quite fully contracted term is actually the same as that one, right? And then there's the completely not contracted terms, of which there is only one. That's a type 3 term. So when we apply Wick's theorem to the thing inside the expectation value up there, we're going to have to cope with three different kinds of terms. And they will lead to three different kinds of diagrams. Remember, a diagram is just an integral. type 1 contributions to star. We'll call that thing, yeah, I've called it star. Look like minus I lambda on 4 factorial Okay, they're actually really easy type 1 contributions. This is just a number. It's just a complex number. So we just get an inner product between momentum eigenstates. So diagrammatically, we have a diagram for integrals over 4 copies of a field operator contracted. We have a picture for that. It's this there. That's exactly the diagram representing this integral. And of course, we have some delta functions here. So type 1 contributions are actually the standard fully contracted contributions you'd expect. So type 2 and 3 that get interesting. Actually, it gets kind of quite complicated. I should put the normal ordering symbol in here. Sorry about that. There it is. Here, we have to cope with the fact that we might contract to the right. We might contract to the left, or we might contract a bit to the right and a bit to the left. So there's quite a lot of possibilities here. I'll write them as A plus B plus C. Yeah, A, B, and C. So A terms look like this. Okay, you've got that contraction straight up coming from the fact that it's partly contracted. Plus you have this. That's a A-type term. So there's several A-type terms. A-type terms have contractions only to the right. Then we have B-type terms. Which have contractions only to the left. And we have C-type terms, so it is a combinatorial nightmare. You have to worry about all these different kinds of terms and where they can contract. But that's it. That's what all the terms are. You can't argue with that. That's combinatorics. So once you've enumerated all these possibilities, you could either leave it in this highly notation-full form, or you could develop a diagrammatic representation for each of these terms. And if you do, then you find that you can draw all these terms of types A, B, and C as a sum of diagrams. So there's a way to do this. I guess we'll call this next part here star star. So we can in fact draw all these nasty terms all down in a bunch of diagrams. And the diagrams look like this. All those terms you can check. Can be represented in terms of these four diagrams here with symmetry factors. So there's lots of extra terms here that add up, right? And that's the diagram we're using for those contractions. So that's the diagrams for type 2. We haven't done type 3 yet. Here they come. this has to be, there's four operators, uncontracted operators in here, and they have to be contracted against these momentum operators there. And if you want to work out this integral, it's not so difficult. You can just work it out as an integral without even bothering with diagrams and so on. And every single term, I mean, there's many, many ways of contracting here, all four operators here against the four external operators. But every such term looks like this. QA plus QB minus P1 minus P2 times X. I'll rewrite that. So when the dust settles, when you work out all the contractions coming in from that expectation value there, you see that they all are in fact equal to this integral here. It's a pretty easy integral. Just imposes momentum conservation. And the picture we have for such a diagram is this. The diagram we have for such an integral is this. That's the way we represent that. If you put all of this together, we can write a diagrammatic expansion, which just means sum of integrals for this T operator here. And the answer is this. That's the full expansion, if you put all together all the things we've observed so far. And in this expansion, if you keep adding up terms in the Taylor series, applying these Wicks, generalized Wicks theorem and drawing pictures down for the integrals, you'll always encounter three types of diagrams. Fully connected diagrams. Fully connected diagrams look like this. I guess that could be a Feynman diagram, so I'll turn that to an ETC. Not fully connected. And that's not fully connected. And the third type are fully connected but multiplied by vacuum bubble. That's not an example of a fully connected multiplied by vacuum bubble. That's just a not fully connected diagram. Okay, I'm going to make the following claim without proof. You can argue this very simply. It's really just chasing Taylor series around. So it's not like a tool that's been extrapolated boldly. And that is the products of vacuum bubbles and fully connected diagrams. The claim is that if you sum up just the type 3 diagrams, then the vacuum bubbles exponentiate. So if you recall the proof for the vacuum bubbles, the exponentiation result, I think you can see it's not ridiculous to think that that'll be quite easy to prove. So this is just an exercise rather than an unclaimed extrapolation, an unproven extrapolation. Sorry. And there's a further claim that the only diagrams that actually contribute to the S matrix are of type 1, which is to say fully connected. All these diagrams don't ultimately connect. All right. But there are still actually problems, because there are fully connected diagrams which have divergences on them. There's an example of a fully connected diagram with problems. If you calculate the integral represented by that diagram, then you will definitely encounter infinity straight up. You could either put a cutoff on it and then allow coupling constants to depend on your cutoff, blah, 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 blah. Or you could first argue that such diagrams don't contribute to the S matrix and save yourself some work. And that's what we're going to do here. So diagrams which represent with external leg corrections, by which I mean you have the external leg, and this external leg is decorated by lots and lots of bubbles. And they're all defined by the fact that you can cut them from the main body of the diagram with one cut. Diagrams such as that can argue, just as represent the process where you project the external momentum eigenstate onto the interacting external eigenstate. and hence they factorize. And because they factorize, we can cut them off. Not in the cutoff sense, but as in the really the with a pair of scissors cut them sense. So to distinguish that, we're going to define something called an amputation procedure. You take some diagram with external leg corrections. Like this. This is a case where watching the video is probably better than writing it down. You take a diagram like this, and you define the amputated version of the diagram by cutting it in exactly one place per external leg. To make this more interesting, we can't amputate this thing because there does not exist a single cut between this and an external. To remove external leg corrections. So the amputation procedure is draw down diagram, and for each external leg, find the point where you can cut the diagram to remove everything that is of the form of an external leg correction. This leads to the final rule for calculating scattering amplitudes with Feynman diagrams. That's the procedure when you summarize in diagram terms for how to eliminate all the vacuum bubbles, all the external leg factorization, all external leg corrections, to summarize them all in your large Taylor series. For the scattering amplitude, we have this rule. The scattering amplitude here is proportional to the sum of all the connected and amputated Feynman diagrams with two with incoming momenta QA and QB and outgoing momenta PF. That's the final rule for how to compute a scattering process with Feynman diagrams. You didn't have to do that. You could have instead have just gone right back to the Taylor series and just laboriously write out every term of the Taylor series and then cancel quotients. That would also give you the same answer. But this is a much more economical way to calculate these processes. And so with that, I'd like to thank you all and wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thank you.